previously, when you wanted to compose music or do music, you would have to go through a digital audio workstation. You have to use a DAW. And DAWs have drop-down menus. What is nice about VR is that it opens up this kind of new realm of user interactions. What I've been doing with this most recent project, which is the interactive beat drop simulator, it's primarily built around two gestures, which is one, the up gesture, which starts intensity rising, and then if you want it to keep rising, you have to gesture up again, and then you do it again and again and again, and that the intensity builds up. In addition to this, like, the music builds up, but also ideally the visuals around you start to get a little bit more intense. The world starts vibrating, colors start shifting a little bit, choreography happens in the world around you, and then there's a downward gesture, which triggers the beat drop, and that's supposed to be super satisfying, where I chose when that would happen. I did it when I felt it was right, you know?
With the gesture and the visuals.
With the gesture, and the visuals take the inputs that you put and, like, react to that.
Boom, what's up, everyone? Welcome to Simulation. I'm your host, Alan Sakian. We are at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in Cambridge, in Massachusetts. We are now going to be talking about interactive audiovisual creation. We have Gregory Osborne joining us on the show. Hello.
Hello.
Thank you so much for coming on. Really appreciate it. I'm very excited. This is a topic that we really have yet to dig deep into. Very pumped to have Greg joining us. He's a recent graduate of Berklee College of Music in Boston, focused on developing the next generation of interactive audiovisual art using video game music implementation, taking advantage of virtual reality and new types of user interfaces. And you can find Greg's links below. Check him out. Greg, let's start things off with this perspective that we find ourselves as stewards of Earth. What is your current take on the state of our world?
I find that recently, especially with the kind of advancements of technology that we've had, especially in the last half century, if not the last, like, century itself, we've found that technology has made it way more accessible for people who have no formal training in art or science, to be honest, in very many fields, to start participating in those fields. There's a lower barrier of entry because technology has made it way easier for people to one, learn what it is that's important for the performance of that job, whether it's art or science or whatever, but also makes it easier for them to share what they have learned so that they can, like, really expand the pool of people who are interested in that subject. So, for example, if I have found this really cool, cheap, easy form of music to create, it becomes really, really easy for me to spread that to my friends so that they can also make that music, and you build up your kind of, you know, culture around that where everyone is sharing. It's really easy to share. It's really fast. You can do it with the click of a button. Check out this track I made. Check out this art that I put up on Tumblr or whatever. It has become really shockingly fast to share your advancements in a field. So what I found is that this hasn't necessarily diminished, like, the value of having really deep knowledge of a thing, because you still can make, like, incredibly nuanced and complicated pieces of art because you have studied this for 20 years. But what it's done is it's opened up this kind of avenue where that's not the only reason to do art. You can also do it just for your friends because you got home from work and you have not been given the amount of, like, expression, self-expression that you desired in your day. I'm sure that's relatable to a few people. And they can go home and they can express themselves with, you know, their hobbies. And not only, it doesn't have to be alone in your basement that you do this. You can also share it with all of your other friends who also probably possibly work similar, you know, jobs that don't fully give them the potential to express themselves. And that's not saying there's any shame in that, but what we've seen is technology has made it way easier to continue to express yourself despite you know, these kind of primary activities that you find yourself doing.
Yes, the people that push the edge of knowledge and build the new tools and technologies that then democratize people's creative ability to contribute is such a great synthesis on the state of the world. I love that. Let's jump into the journey. So you were raised in DC.
Yes.
And then you went to the Berklee College of Music here in Boston. I want to know, tell me about the journey and what sparked your interest in music.
Well, musically, I've been playing classical. I was classically trained in piano since the age of five. It was kind of the thing my parents were like, do you want to do this? And I kind of said yes to most of their suggestions at the time. I was five. So I did. I found that I really enjoyed it, just playing piano. Interestingly, I don't really play that much piano anymore. I kind of got sidetracked into composition around the ninth grade because of my like piano playing skills. They put me into the honors program at the Levine School of Music, where I got access to, most importantly, this one workshop, which was everybody writes a song as a group. And I remember like writing the song as a group with the lyrics and everything. And I enjoyed that song so much that when they failed to send that song to us after the event was over, I asked them multiple times and I never got it. I went back and I spent an entire weekend rewriting it for myself. It was the song called My GPS Lies. It was basically comparing your GPS to a girlfriend, like a bad girlfriend. It was like a poor dysfunctional relationship. And so I enjoyed that idea so much. I was like, this, I want to hear it again, but they don't send us the file of us singing it. So I ended up remaking it. And so that kind of started me on the process of composition, as opposed to just playing music. My father kind of was a DJ in his spare time. It's like as a hobby. And so he used Ableton for that. Ableton is this program that can be used for DJing, and it requires a bit of setup, and you do it, and that was kind of how he performed it, but it's also primarily a music making tool. So when he heard that I had an interest in composition, he was like, you should try this program. And so I got that program, and that's the program I've mostly been using for the past 5 or so years to create music.
Till today.
Ableton. It's a digital audio workstation called a DAW for short. Mm-hmm. And you might hear me say that again later.
Cool.
It's mostly used for electronic composition, so that's kind of the music that I make right now. It's mostly electronic, though. Mm-hmm. That has changed since I came to Berklee.
And is this still, when you were using Ableton last 5 years, is this really still the clicking and dragging into timeline sequences?
One of the nice things about Ableton, actually, is it kind of revolutionized a new type of composition, which was their... not arrangement view, which is what you were mentioning, but
it's
the session
called an arrangement view.
There's the arrangement view, which is where you click and it's linear.
Linear, yes.
But Ableton also has the session view, which is where you amass all your clips in like this kind of spreadsheet, essentially, and you can program behavior into its playback so that you can trigger clips non-linearly. So you can change your arrangement on the fly based on the music that, you know, it becomes a live performance. And so that's what a lot of people will use, especially now, for live performances for electronic music, because you're not necessarily up there with a guitar shredding, but what you can do is you can show off your prowess with all these kind of inputs and like hardware and triggering the right dials and buttons at the right time to perform the piece of music that you wrote electronically. So that's kind of one of the things Ableton excels at.
And that's also partly, that's where you can add a sequence of a couple things and then have that become a program that repeats.
You can just loop it. You can have a bunch of clips trigger at the same time. You can design instruments with like macros that use specific dials that you adjust to change parameters live. It created basically a new type of performance for electronic music.
The digital audio workstation.
It's a digital audio workstation. It doesn't. Most digital audio workstations don't have that feature. That digital audio workstation mostly just for creation of music.
Yes.
It's just the program that you use for that.
And then you can actually get your ability to actually do
To perform it live.
What is the scratch, is this, what is this?
Well, this is like turntables.
A turntable, is a scratch a turntable? Well,
that's not what Ableton is mostly for.
But what is that?
This is scratching, turntables.
So there is an additional, potentially a physical unit that one can use to have a scratching of turntables as well to do like a physical kind of thing.
And you can record performances of that with your, that would normally be separate gear though. I'm sure you can find a plugin that helps you do that just in the program.
And did you end up picking electronic music around when you were starting doing this, and then you kept doing it through Berklee?
Yeah, sort of. I found electronic music a little bit earlier than I've had the access and means to produce it myself. But it's kind of just like my musical tastes evolve kind of slowly based on YouTube videos that I watched and the music that they used in like gaming montages was often electronic. So the particular artist that I listened to ended up like fueling my love of electronic music. But now I've gotten incredibly nuanced and deep, as most musicians at Berklee will with their musical tastes. You know, the people make really deep dives into specific things, and I'm not different.
Yes. And now, this is cool. You're teaching me about CWP, which means contemporary writing and production. And this is for all different types of things, film, games, etc. So teach us about what this major even is.
Yeah. So this is at Berklee College of Music in Boston. It's one of many majors that you can take here. Contemporary writing and production tends to be the kind of generalist composer, where it's not necessarily you as a like specific artist producing music under your own name, but it's for all the rest of the music that surrounds us in daily life, be it in advertisements, in YouTube videos, for example. You can arrange, sometimes when somebody writes a cool piece of music, but they need it like arranged in for different bands, like one for a band, one for an orchestra, one for five flutes and a fiddle or something, they hire somebody to just arrange that for them. So that's a skill that you learn in this major. It's kind of just like general writing of music, as well as recording it. It tries to be a mix of a lot of different things.
And do you need to know sheet music?
Yes.
To do this, so you need to know how to position musical notes on a musical bar.
Yeah, and there's programs that help you do that.
And how long they go for?
Yeah.
And what? What is it, an accent?
Yeah, accent, articulations, like the different types of notes that you can...
Interesting.
Make. Yeah, and there's... I actually have a friend of mine who specializes in just getting music onto the page in a way that's clear and legible.
Wow.
So people will have like, you know, orchestral scores or whatever, like music that they have written in their head, and they have like... you know, this kind of mock-up, and he will go just into the program and make sure the score is clean and all the parts are very legible and very clear about what they do, because that actually, it's a process, it takes a bit of time. Mm-hmm. He's actually doing one right now for me. Wow. And that's just what he does, it's his specialization. That's kind of a beautiful thing about Berklee, is that they're all geniuses, but like at very specific things, and all the things are different.
This is kind of like nice. Score cleanup, or like the music sheet cleanup.
Just because it's tedious. It's like it's a hard thing, and there is a certain amount of art to it to make it as clear and concise to the player who is reading the music, so that they can accurately reflect the wishes of the composer. That's not easy. It's not necessarily always like just. Well, it'll happen. It does take a bit of work and effort.
And a score can be used for a film or a video game or a commercial. There's like so many different places.
Yeah, music is everywhere. Like, people write music for lots of things. There's like entire libraries just where people can go. It's like, I need music for this kind of mood. And you'll just go to the library and pay for that music really fast and just use it. That's another, for example, option for COEP people, is to just write music for libraries that gets used in Lord knows what place, because there's so many places that use music, but, you know, somebody has to make it first.
And what would a CWP kind of process maybe look like for, give us like what you would learn and maybe a general or two like that are important, and then how you'd focus?
There's a lot of different paths that you can take with this major. They teach you how to arrange for specific groups of instruments, like how do you even write for horns? How do you write for strings and for flutes and clarinets and the woodwind family? And how do you effectively use percussion? And you have to like learn about the roles of this. Of all these instruments, you would learn like just basic techniques that have been used in recent like contemporary music. So like different harmonies, how you stack up harmonies together, how horns are used effectively in one genre versus another genre, how they are typically used, like genre tropes. Of course, you can get CWP offers a lot of deeper dives into specific genres that you might be interested in. Just to specialize in a specific type of music writing. I specialize more in electronic music, but especially recently, like hybridizing that with orchestral written music with live instruments and kind of blending that together. And that's my specific kind of focus that I did within the CWP major. Of course, my primary focus at Berklee was video game music and composition for that kind of medium. And so that's really what I've been mostly focusing on. Of course, Berklee, if you take the contemporary writing and production major, you will be good at writing music, like at minimum. So they teach you that pretty well.
But electric and orchestral music for video game.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be for video games necessarily, but that is the kind of, that's where I tend to use my compositions. That's the kind of field I'm trying to focus on.
That your focus was, you also made it crazy interesting that you have to learn how to write for horns and for woodwinds.
Yeah, they have
how
different
they stack for
techniques.
Harmonies was interesting. Yeah, yeah.
Blending different orchestral textures is its whole entire art. Like,
wow.
One of my teachers is just like, just listen to the way he orchestrated this. Listen to the choices he made and like where the in octaves they are playing or who is on top of who and how that changes the character. There's a lot of nuance to everything about music. It's not easy necessarily to get great at.
There's so much nuance, and I love how were explaining to me earlier within video game music composition, which is where you're super passionate about. There's this big there's a huge difference, and this is hard to capture when we're just engaging with content. We're not necessarily thinking about how difficult it was to create it and the nuance there. But like, just like at a restaurant, you don't think about all the operations in the background.
No, and they don't want you to. That's also kind of similar to video game music. You don't want to make it obvious what the systems are behind it, right? Most of the time, the purpose is to just have it just happen to perfectly score what it is you're doing. Like, you want it to be subtle. Like, so a
but
lot
you
of,
want to be able to double click in and investigate when you want.
Yeah, and that's kind of like, but that's the stuff that video game composers will do when they play a game. Is they'll deliberately try to break the music playback just to see how it works. But under normal gaming circumstances, you're trying to make it just so that it happens. It happens magically and without anybody noticing.
In as gorgeous of a way as possible.
Exactly.
You made this really clear to me. I was like, holy crap, this is crazy. So like, when you make the score for a film, all of the music is linear, and then when you are making the music library for a video game, there's what's the sound when the door is opened? What's the sound when you enter into a shower?
Right.
There's like, this is really complicated. When do these things play? How are these cataloged? And how did you create them in the first place? How do all the algorithms and math work as well? Teach us about this. This is so interesting.
Sure. Well, there's a lot of different parameters often that you have to take account for. One of the kind of most basic building blocks of the music part of video game music implementation is the loop. So you have music that will continue indefinitely as long as you need it to, because one of the key defining features of game audio is that you can't make them do a thing most of the time. Although you can sometimes script things, and there's some games, like art games, for example, that like have specific timed moments. But normally you want them to feel natural, like it feels like a narrative progression that made sense. But often the time you'll be defining how loops transition into each other and with what music and how fast, how reactive. So for example, in some cases where you have a bunch of pieces of music that are all the same tempo, you can kind of define the transition so that they always happen on the beat, so it always makes sense. And you can also add on top of that another piece of music that plays to kind of mask that transition. So one very common trope I hate to ruin games for you now is a cymbal swell, which is, and on the is when the music changes. And stuff like that, that's generally called like a transition segment or a stinger. A stinger is more of a thing that happens at any point, just a piece of music that plays when you either like open a box, like in Zelda. And so that's like a stinger that just plays at any time. There's a piece of music, but there's also sound
effects.
That's
an algorithm, so it's actually attached to the treasure box.
Yeah, so when you open that, that's when it plays. So you have to define either if it can be like opening a box, it could be moving from location to other location.
When you enter into another scene, you could change the music.
Yeah, and you don't always know exactly where you'll exit from the last piece of music unless you specifically define that.
So there has to be a transition to make it kind of smooth.
It doesn't have to be smooth necessarily. There's perfectly valid places where it just fades out and then fades back in again. That is a perfectly like natural way, but the artistic decision of where that's appropriate versus where you really want to keep the pace going versus where you want them to like notice off in the distance like a piece of music that is directly spatialized to that location. And like, that's a place I want to go to. That is a kind of that often will like be tied to the specific piece of music that you're playing. It might not even be heard ever. But if you get close to that location, you'll hear this new layer of music on top of the music that's already playing, and that's defined by
question.
Yes.
Okay. So if when we're moving more towards the surround sound and then to the ambisonics, these 360 degree places, we're saying that there's potentially going to be, let's say, a building that has some sort of music that's coming from it, and we're hearing it like in our background, and then the closer we get to it, so it's always playing. That building in the video game music is always playing, but it's spatially in that location. That way I can, that's some complicated stuff to know how loud to play the music based on how close the character is.
That's part of the mixing process. So a lot of game audio implementation is playing the game a lot to make sure that layer of music isn't drowning out all the other pieces of music that might also be playing. Maybe as you get closer to that building, you encounter enemies and suddenly battle music plays or something, or gunshots happen and you have to make decisions as to what you want to be the focus. Like, do you want the building sound to be the focus, or do you want the bullets whizzing past your head to be the focus? Or all those kind of decisions are part of what makes up a general kind of game mix for the non-linear music, and often you'll have competing sources of music that's like, there's battle music, but there's also this exploratory music that has this radio playing or whatever, and there's the kind of difference between music that kind of just plays underscore and music that's specifically sourced in the game that you know where it's coming from. The same thing for kind of like sound effects. Like, there's some sound effects that you need to know the position for, like where enemies are versus getting hurt. That's kind of an internal thing. Like, you're getting hurt, so you don't have to worry about where that's coming from. You know where it's coming from. Okay. That just happens in 2D, and so you can just play that directly into your ears, and you don't have to route that into whatever spatializer you're using for all the positioned sound effects.
It seems crazy thinking about every step that you take makes a sound in a game.
Footsteps are like a meme.
Why?
Because every person who does video game sound effects has to make footsteps. It's like a part of almost So like either you have your library of footsteps that you just use on everyone, but what if people will notice? So then you have to change or find different footsteps.
When you're walking in grass versus on
dirt. There's a lot of different materials. Sometimes games have like metal and then glass that you walk on, or have different, maybe you wade through a river, and when you wade through a river, you have to make sure that the footsteps start getting wet and then fade out completely as you start swimming. And then as you get to the end of the thing. So we can't always just be playing. You have to define those states.
This is crazy. So give us an idea of how many audio designers work on, and engineers work on, just a single complex video game. Like a sandbox, potentially, style.
Okay. Because like there's different layers of video games, right? There's like indie games, which are generally smaller, sometimes work with as little as like one audio person because, you know, they don't have the budget for a composer and a sound designer. But like AAA games will have like flocks, like, you know, many sound designers working on the different footsteps, you know, especially if you're on a tight schedule. You know, you have to organize a structure where the creative vision is being explained to the one guy at the top. Yeah. And he's like, all right, I don't like that sound effect because it's too magical and we're too much in a sci-fi universe. So try and change that. They have to make those creative decisions, and they kind of have their teams working on either footsteps for characters. Sometimes one you'll focus on one character and all the sounds associated with them. Things like that. So yes, there's a lot of people working on sound. That's an important part of the game.
Huge.
It makes a massive impact on your enjoyment of it, especially if it's poorly implemented. Then you're like, I hear that sound again and again and again, and it makes me tired and not want to play the game.
And then there's a composer and a sound designer.
Often it doesn't. That doesn't. There's nowhere is it written that has to be the case. But it tends to divide up on bigger projects better if you have one person working on music and one person working on like making all the individual sounds. And they'll probably work together very closely to make sure that the general vibe is similar and mesh as well. Often they have to choose a key to make sound effects in. To make sure that harmonically it doesn't kind of clash too much, especially for the more pitched sound effects that you might have in a game. So they work, collaborate together, but there's a lot of work that has to be done. So they do separate it out often into like music writers, and then there's their team of editors that goes through and through all the either recordings of an orchestra that they did to make the music, or the session file that they, if it's electronic music, for example, they'll get the actual file and then they'll separate it into different layers that can play at different times, because layering is a very common implementation technique for video games, where it's like, you want to build intensity, we'll just add the music in, and then we add the third level of music in, and then you add the fourth one, oh my god, you're succeeding so much, but somebody has to go in and like divide those, and often, you know, a composer, especially for larger games, a composer will just write the music, record the music, have a mixer mix it, and then you have like a team of editors who go through and make decisions as to what goes on what layer at what time, and how to implement it.
And the way that you're teaching us about the video game music composition is so similar to the video game that we're in right now. Because there's cars on Memorial Drive back there that we can hear. There's people that walk in and out of the doors in the hallway right now that slam in and out. When you walk, you hear the footsteps. Yeah. This is such an interesting sort of world of all of I'm glad you give us this perspective, because we don't typically just think about all of the different noises in the kitchen, all the different noises in the office.
But it's, you can take some time to think about that. Like, nothing is stopping you from just like sitting in a place and being like, what do I hear right now? And that's often an exercise that they ask us to do.
I love that exercise.
Because often in video games, the things that really sells the world and really sells immersion is like a bunch of tiny little details about the room that when you notice them, you know, it's like, oh, wow. Especially in sound design, for example. Like, when you build a sound, like a sword, like, hitting a person, right? You have to try and put in as much detail into that sound as possible. So it's not only the swoosh of the sword and the collision of the sword on the person, but sometimes the enemy that you're hitting is going to be wearing armor. And so you have an armor sound, or it makes a different sound when they're not wearing armor because you broke it. Or you also want to have a different sound for it if it's a bleeding. You know, sword, it causes bleeding or poison or whatever. You can add that kind of sound effect on top of that based on the type of weapon you're using.
If it hits the center of the blade versus the tip of the
blade.
Yeah,
and that will be more important as we go into VR because often in video games, you don't necessarily have that direct control over an object and the sound that it creates. But as we go into more physics-based kind of virtual reality games, how sound is created and propagates becomes even more important.
Yes.
So, like, where the collision happens on the sword becomes important, you know, so that you can, when you clang, the clang happens from there. If you, like, if the sword, collision is right here, you want it to happen here and not on the tip of the sword or at the handle, you need to make sure that you position the sounds where they would be in real life. And a lot of that is, it gets more complicated as you get into virtual reality because
the haptics from the vibration.
Yeah.
I mean, this
and
is some
as you embody stuff. The space, you notice the failures of sound implementation more.
That.
You know, it's different when you're looking at a 2D screen and you're like, oh, there's an enemy over there, you know, in that general direction. Then you move your mouse to look in that direction and it pans so that it's in front of you. But when you're in VR, it matters not just what direction it's coming from. It matters the elevation it's coming from.
Yes.
It matters what objects are around it, that how the reverb works, how the sound kind of echoes and reflects off the room. So for example, this room, you can hear a bit of reverb, especially when we talk a little louder. And that's because we've got glass here and we've got glass on the other side, and it kind of just bounces back and forth for a bit, and it makes it sound a little bit more live than it would be in a room that was like all carpet. And so, especially as you go into VR...
Which is why people put up the soundproofing
for example,
prevent the reverb from happening.
Yeah, but as you go into a game, the kind of environment that you're in, if that footstep sounds like it's in a completely dry room, you know, but you're in a cavern or you're in like a church, you know, you want that footstep to have the same amount of reflections as it would in that real space. And
yes.
It matters even more in VR than it does in games. And it already... There's a couple of really...
You have to measure, have to maybe take like a boom mic to a church and then maybe record it that way versus like
people,
in a field.
Do that. That's called convolution reverb, where you like fire a gun, or more commonly now you have like a kind of sine wave to measure how all the frequencies reflect off the space. That's convolution reverb. That's for like really accurate representations of one position in a space. What's interesting, though, is that when you make that measurement, and let's say you're in the center of the church, the reverb is going to be different when you walk over to the wall.
Wall.
And then when you walk over to the altar.
You guys are crazy. How do you do this?
So one way is to like do the calculations using ray casting, which is this thing where you like fire a ray in all directions often. One of the games that does this really well is The Last of Us. They have their when somebody talks and walks behind a wall, then the reverb changes based on where you would hear them. Another game that does this incredibly well is Rainbow Six Siege. It's a shooter, team-based shooter, because the environment is destructible around you, it becomes really important that the sound propagates through that environment super realistically. Otherwise, if you're standing next to a wall, like if there's a wall right here and there's an enemy on the other side of it, and there's a door right here, when the enemy walks by, I should not be able to shoot him through the wall based on sound alone. I need to hear that sound through the door over here. So that's where I hear. So I can tell that there's somebody in the hallway, but I can't necessarily tell that they're right next to me across from this wall.
And meanwhile, someone on this side of the building is breaking down one of those
surfaces.
Especially
if it's like on the third floor, a massive explosion happens. You don't hear the explosion, you hear a bunch of reverb from that explosion, and you can, it positions itself from the doorway from which you would hear that.
Okay, we spent so much time talking about this, Greg.
It gets incredibly complicated.
It's so beautiful, too, talking about it.
I can geek out about it a lot.
And I think you'll actually end up teaching us more about it as we get a little deeper into some of the hardware and software side of things, which, all right, let's dive into this. So you're very interested in making albums of interactive music. So, and I want, we'll have you explain this, but we're talking about how to make this video game music composition. This requires hardware, this requires software, this things like Unity, Unreal, also all of the VR hardware, AR hardware is this now out there. But this albums of interactive music thing, this kind of loops us all the way back to the democratization.
Right.
So teach us about this and how you're building this.
Well, take for example Unity, which is free to download, and you can make a game in Unity for free, and if it like achieves, I think, a certain amount of success, they take a cut of that, basically. But if you want to learn how to make games, you can just download Unity and make one using the tools that they've got there. And there's also a large amount of free assets on the asset store on Unity that you can use to mess around with and see what it would look like if you made a game like this or like that. And that kind of experience to be able to just like go out and use it. Of course, it's good for Unity because if you want to make a big game, you've developed all these skills and you're used to this particular engine in the way that it works. So of course, when you make a big game, you're going to be like, yeah, I'm going to use the thing that I know how to use. Of course, you can also take it as a challenge to try and do it in another platform like Unreal or Game Maker, or there's a couple of tools out there that you can use to make a game. But the entry is, do you have enough space on your hard drive to download this program and then go mess around with that?
But cloud is now in effect or not yet? The cloud computations?
I'm not sure. That's not really I don't know much about that necessarily.
Hopefully at some point it gets so democratized that you don't even need a really powerful hardware. Locally, you can just,
It'll happen at some point, I imagine. But in addition to that, there's sound implementation in Unity that you can do, and one of the things about Unity is that if you know enough coding, you can set up some crazy things, and people will sell packages that they made to do stuff that would be very difficult to make just coding yourself, but you can just go out and get a package that does that thing in Unity for you. But one thing that you can do is, from an audio perspective, right? There's a couple of programs that are audio middleware engines that essentially take the audio functionality out of Unity and just put in a different program, and then those tools are designed to be much more efficient. Like from a user perspective, it's like, I want this thing to loop, and then every time it loops, I want to make sure it plays the reverb tail at the end while still starting at the beginning. That's difficult in Unity because your loops have to be perfect. And you have to have the reverb tail from the end of the song at the beginning of the song so that you don't hear a click. But if you're in Wise, it's really easy to set up. You just put the beginning marker, you put the end marker of what you want it to loop in between, and then all the sound that comes after that, it just kind of continues playing as it goes to the beginning. So it makes it easier. This is Wise. There's also FMOD. I think
audio middleware. Interesting. Yeah. These integrators that work, that's so cool that there's now markets for that.
Yeah.
And also, I want to see something that makes it easy to be able to, like you said, to take what you have as your current audio in Unity out and then bring it in with the middleware that you use.
Yeah.
I just want it to be more frictionless. Too many times we hear about people that, that like lose a year's worth of work because of software updates or whatever, all different types of things.
I mean, it does take a bit of time. had some an embarrassing long amount of time before I got Wise and Unity to work together because of one step that I missed in the process of just getting sound. And that's kind of a thing I've gotten used to, especially because I work in kind of newer VR spaces, is I often just build in 5 hours of time at the beginning of every project to have nothing work and frantic Googling to try and figure out why the project won't even load. Like, that's just kind of like, I've come to expect that. but a lot of it is like YouTube tutorials online that you can just watch, and yeah, the companies will put up there and you just watch them, yeah, and then you're like, oh, that's what I missed. I'll just go and do that, and then the sound works, and then you kind of build up. Honestly, YouTube tutorials are the most underrated source of learning in this world.
I agree so much, yeah. And mentors, one-on-one mentors.
I just sat with a friend of mine who for a class has to implement Wise and Unity together, and in that process, we ran into one of these bugs that it wouldn't generate a sound bank for Mac, or we didn't know how to get it to do that, so it would only work on Windows but not on the Mac that we were using at the time. And so struggling through that process and just like banging your head against a wall, just trying to figure out why it's not working, that is very common. But it doesn't happen again. Every time, as in, like, once you figured that out, you get further. It's like a video game. You get further and further and further as you unlock the skills. You have the keys to unlock that door, and then you know the puzzle that you have to solve for that door, and you know the quick shortcut through the Dark Souls level that skips past the first boss, and you get better at developing games and implementing audio and whatever it is you kind of want to do. And what's nice is that there's often entire communities dedicated to helping you out, which it just makes me feel so at home. It's like, yes, like, I had this exact question. Thank you for explaining it to me in 15 minutes. It would have taken me literal hours to figure that out if you hadn't done that.
Correct.
And,
correct.
You know.
Yes, yes. And I want you to give us the, you know, this ties us into the fascinating intro, music systems that non-musicians can exercise creative control over. This is the albums of interactive music.
Right.
You gave some beautiful examples of being able to build up the beats
and
then drop them when you're in the spatial environment.
I call it an interactive beat drop simulator. The idea being that previously, when you wanted to compose music or do music, you would have to go through a digital audio workstation. You have to use a DAW. And DAWs have drop-down menus. And DAWs have... there have been like significant advancements in trying to make it as easy as possible for non-musicians to do what they want with audio in these digital audio workstations. GarageBand has like a bunch of behind-the-scenes stuff that it does to your sound, like adding reverb to it and creating buses for you when you create a new track. And it really tries to make the process as simple as possible, but ultimately, making music that you would like is difficult. It takes a bit of practice and investments of time that not everybody necessarily has, although I would encourage you to invest that time to try and give yourself some amount of self-expression. But what is nice about VR is that it opens up this kind of new realm of user interactions, where you put your hands and how you move them can be used in a kind of more natural way, I suppose, than like using a mouse and a keyboard to kind of click around. Like, music, amazing music happens that way, but you do kind of have to know to some extent what you're going for. A lot of people who start out have like music in their head that they know they want to make, but they don't know how to do it. And I still run into that problem right now. I beatbox music that I know I would not be able to make in the amount of time it takes for me to beatbox it. It's like, this is the sound I want to go to. You know,
yeah.
I want to do that. I would, like, that would probably take me 30 minutes, an hour, and this is me having, like, 5 years of music experience to just recreate that sound that I just made. Like, it's there. Why can't I just use that? But it's,
and you can capture you doing it and then import it?
Well, you can capture that. What I've been doing with this most recent project, which is the Interactive Beat Drop Simulator, is while I'm trying to figure out the music system, I've been just beatboxing the music. So when I'm playing it right now, it's just me beatboxing riser. So the way it works is when it's primarily built around two gestures, which is one, the up gesture, which starts intensity rising, and then if you want it to keep rising, you have to gesture up again, and then you do it again and again and again, and that the intensity builds up. In addition to this, like, the music builds up, but also ideally the visuals around you start to get a little bit more intense. The world starts vibrating, colors start shifting a little bit, choreography happens in the world around you, and then there's a downward gesture, which triggers the beat drop, and that's supposed to be super satisfying, where I chose when that would happen. I did it when I felt it was right, you know?
With the gesture and with the visuals.
And the visuals take the inputs that you put and, like, react to that. Yeah. Of course, this is not composition, right? This is me creating an experience for you that you can play back, you know, and I composed the music so that it would sound dramatic, and I made the system in Wise so that it would, you know, it would time it to the beat so that no matter when you drop down, it'll always happen in time, and things like that. But as this kind of field advances of using gestures to make musical flourishes when you go, and then when you select specific items, or if you point, especially as we lose the controllers and move towards just knowing what your hands look like, you'll be able to more and more easily create an experience that you just dance music into being. And it can be, to some extent, you can have it be random. A lot of work will be put on defining what some gestures are, teaching new users what gestures they can even do. Like, I want you, ideally, to experience all of the cool stuff that I made. But to teach you how to unlock those gestures, there's a certain amount of time that you would have to invest into learning how it works and whatever. And that's mostly just art. But I hope at some point the kind of boundaries become such that you feel as if you are an integral part of this composition, you know, that you chose these things. When the beat drop is playing back, you make some decisions to put effects on top of digital signal processing, or you can smack objects that appear in front of you that temporarily play one, like, piece of music instead of the music you would be listening to otherwise, to give them tools so that they have as much control over what they listen to as possible, but it still sounds good no matter what they do.
Yeah, that's a huge part of it. Yes. Yeah, and then you're also moving to build an album, so it's the beat dropper is just one of many. Then I can do this immersive beat dropper, share it with other people, make it social. There's so much.
And there's other ideas, which is like just a gesture-based remixer, where no matter what music is playing, when I do a gesture, it'll either mute it or it'll go, or I can, like, chop it up a little bit. I could, like, make a gesture to repeat it over and over again. And so, for example, I have I had a little bit of experience teaching kids. They got access to a studio as part of the Boys and Girls Club. There's a music clubhouse thing. So they got access to a studio, and what they wanted to do was not compose music as much as they wanted to rap over it. Yeah. You know, they would go on YouTube and they would download free music. They would just YouTube to MP3, and then they would go into the studio and just rap over it, and they would share it with their own friends. Yes, you know, that's who they did it for. Yes. They did it to show off, and it's like to show the bars that they had. Yeah, yeah. But what if there was a really easy way for them to not only just not, there already is an easy way for them to rip music off of YouTube, but what if there was a way for them to exert creative control over that music? What
in a spatial environment.
In a spatial environment where they could perform it and possibly record themselves doing that, like put it on social media. So
that's
like, this
huge.
Is the bars that I do. And in addition to those gestures that change the music, they can also change the visual environment around
yes.
them. They can record that and make creative decisions based on the visual environment that
that's
they're performing
in. That's
so
cool. In. This is all in your revision roadmap.
Vision roadmap. Yeah, this is like a long way down. I am but one person, and hopefully the projects that I do and release, I intend to make a YouTube channel dedicated to how did I do that? This is how you do it.
Crucial,
you know,
yes.
Quick 15-minute video, how do I set up this beat drop simulator?
Yes.
You know, quick 15-minute video, how do I make it so that the visuals react to the bass drum in one way, but react to the higher frequency snare drum in a different way, so that when I give them a drum set with a bass and a snare, the boom, 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 ka, ka, boom, ka, 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 boom, boom, ka, the visuals are reflected based on that.
That's so
you know,
sweet.
And whatever music is playing underneath.
Teaching people how to then make and build on top of where you've been pushing the edge in these spatial environments.
I hope so.
I love this. This is one of the biggest futures of like the way millennials and Gen Z think, is that it's not just about pushing the edge, but it's about capturing how you push the edge to help have other people push it.
I want to see other people's better art.
Likewise.
And of course, I think everybody, a lot of artists will be like, like the imposter syndrome things. Like, what am I even doing here? I don't deserve this kind of thing. And for me, sometimes it's like that with like, I mean, yeah, I designed this cool system, but like, somebody will make better music for it, or somebody will make it smoother. Like the gesture is—it's really clunky right now. It doesn't perfectly sync up with the beat or whatever, or the tools that I'm using just aren't fluid enough. But the hope is that I will get to experience other people's improvements on that, and I want to. I hope that people make it better.
You started walking us through some of the design tools of the future in this audiovisual engineering space. Teach us about where you think that's heading.
The audiovisual space?
And in the spatial space as well, of course.
Well,
yes,
I think a huge amount of where we're going is being able to collaborate in the same space using the same tools when you're physically separated in distances. And we've seen this in like conference calls, for example. Like there's, you know, you call in and everybody's in VR and there's a guy with a presentation at the front of the room, right, doing a presentation, that's one way. Like the Star Wars kind of hologram effect, right, for VR, where everyone's sitting around the table and some of them are virtual. But in addition to that, I think if you build up a community of people who use the same artistic tools in different ways, which is a very common experience. People use the same DAW, like digital audio workstation, and make wildly different music, right? But it's difficult for them to work on the same one because most of the time there's one keyboard and one mouse and one way to input those shortcuts that you know. And like, so often when you collaborate, it's one person inputting all the things and another person being like, what if you did this? Drag that onto here and see what it sounds like. Try and automate this. And so they're like giving suggestions, but there's not as much of a way to directly do that thing. But for example, one of the things that VR is going to do is going to, if you have a comprehensive enough set of like gestures and controls such that everybody can be collaborating on the same piece of art at the same time using the same tools, then in the same space, for example, and talking to each other in the same space and having all those tools perhaps like in different areas so you can tell who's working on what. That can be used for music, for live performances of music even. You can use it for art, you know, like
engineering.
Everybody who like, I have a specific artistic style. I use this brush in such a way, and that's kind of my unique identity, is because I've gotten really good at effectively using this one tool in this particular way. I think it'll become way easier to
location agnostic collaborations in digital spaces.
And everyone has the same tools,
yeah,
right, in the same place, and they're all working on it at the same time.
Yeah,
right?
It seems to be such a massive part of our future.
Yeah, it'll be fun. you know, to be able to create with other people in the room with you.
Yeah, yeah, but there's also something about the what we get from the millions of years of eye to eye human to human. So there'll be the balance that we strike with that for at least a while. We'll see how that ends
up as we get better. I mean, we're not, the hardware is still, and I hope this always stays the case, does not live up to our imagination of what it could be. But it will get better, I assume, I hope.
Until you're indistinguishable, from the physical environment.
And then it'll be easier to work with other people doing the same things and exerting your kind of, your creative impulses on a piece of work as other people are doing the same. I hope that happens sooner.
Yes, yes. And this is an interesting lead into our last two questions. Of course, as Greg becomes digitally indistinguishable from his physical self, we must ask, are we in a simulation?
Are we in a simulation? I mean, the easy cop-out is, does it matter? Mostly because, I mean, for me, I enjoy this. I am happy with where I am. And to say that there's something that's more real than my lived experience, it's like, no, sure. I mean, let's say there's like a Greg that's in a vat somewhere or something, and like with electrodes tied to his brain. I feel, making meaningful creative changes to this world, you know? And I am experiencing their repercussions. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm doing cool stuff. I'm working on cool projects. I'm creating stuff that I don't see in the world, right? I'm making those changes and I'm seeing how they impact the world, hopefully.
Yeah.
Right? And in that case, that's meaning to me. I don't really need a deeper one.
And then the last question, Greg, is what is the most beautiful thing in the world?
I enjoy staying in one spot and just letting things happen around me in ways that I can try to come to understand. Like, to sit and just, as things happen, be like, how does that work? You know, this happens a lot more with sound than it does with other things for me. But it's like, that was a cool effect. Whoa, what just happened over there? That kind of thing. Like, yes. how did that reflection occur? Why is the sound behaving that way? You know, how would I try and imitate that? Like, to follow up on the simulation thing, I am in the business of making simulations.
Yes. So,
If I was in one, how did they do that?
Yeah. That's
right? I want to do that. I want to make that for other people.
Like deja vu. Because
it's cool.
How did they do that? How do I make that for other people?
It's cool. I think it's cool. There's some really, if you stop and listen, there's some really cool effects that you notice that you wouldn't have noticed if you didn't stop.
Love, right? Things like, how do you make love happen in a digital, that you build love into a digital world?
Right. Well, that's separate. I found that outside of virtual reality.
Greg, this has been such a good conversation. Thank you so much for coming on the show and teaching us. There's so much to still understand about interactive audiovisual creation in general and what the next generation of video game music implementation, especially with virtual reality and new user interfaces, is going to be like. It's been such a pleasure. Thank you.
Of course.
Thank you for coming on. Yeah. Everyone, check out the links below to Greg's work. Go and support him. Also, give us your thoughts in the comments below on the episode. We'd love to hear from you. Go and share more content about these fields with your friends, your family, your coworkers online. Let's get people understanding the craziness of video game music implementation and audiovisual engineering creation in general, and democratizing this art. And support the artists, entrepreneurs, and organizations around the world that you believe in. Simulations links are below. Support us as well. Let us keep coming to awesome places like Cambridge to do interviews. And go and build the future, everyone. Manifest your dreams into the world. We love you very much. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you soon. Peace. Greg, good job, brother.
Woo!